10 years ago, in a galaxy very, very near, George Lucas imagined a world no one else had ever seen. When he placed it on screen in Star Wars in 1977, he asked us to see it through the eyes of a restless and idealistic young man, Luke Skywalker. If it required an act of high imagination to create a lovable droid, think of what was involved in creating a new star for Empire.
When I came to the second film to start working on The Empire Strikes Back, a lot of the information and the training that takes place was originally designed to be done by Ben. But since I killed off Ben in the first film, it left me with a lot of exposition, a lot of training scenes that I didn't have anybody to perform. So I had to come up with a new Jedi Master who was even more powerful than Ben. And I had to come up with somebody who would be interesting to watch.
I am wondering, why are you here?
I'm looking for someone.
Looking? Well, someone you have, I would say.
Right.
Help you again? Yes?
I don't think so. I'm looking for a great warrior.
Oh! Great warrior? War's not to make one great.
I mean, I was very apprehensive about how that was going to work. Could I take a main character in a movie and use a little rubber puppet? And would that, I mean, is it going to happen or is it just going to be a disaster? And right up until the moment where he was on film and talking, it looked like it was going to be a disaster. You know, little hints, but it looks pretty good. Frank can do some really funny things, and that sort of seems to work, and is it going to happen? But then when it goes onto the screen, it's magic.
Oh, you're making a mess. Hey, do that.
Mine, or I will help you not.
I don't want your help. I want my lamp back. I'm going to need it to get out of this slimy mud hole.
Mud hole? Slimy? My home, this is. What?
Archie, let him have it.
Mine!
R2! Move along, little fellow. We got a lot of work to do.
No. Stay and help you, I will. Find your friend.
I'm not looking for a friend. I'm looking for a Jedi Master.
Jedi Master? Yoda. You seek Yoda.
You know him?
Take it to him, I will. Yes. But now, let's eat. Come. Good food. Come.
I think more than anything else with Star Wars is the characters have always been a surprise and a delight as they've come to life.
The surprise and delight of Jedi were those furry, funny, and ferocious little creatures of the forest who, like Yoda before them, would turn out to be a great deal more than merely adorable.
Cut it out!
What none of us knew when we first met them was that they had the power to overthrow a mighty empire. Language establishes character. Composer John Williams takes a short course in Ewokese from Ben Burtt, who invented all the Star Wars dialects.
The pitch is sort of midget-like. Also, if the voice is going to be sped up a little bit or raised in pitch, the way these have been, if you start out with, an average human voice, mine or Jim Bloom, and you raise it in pitch, it tends to sound a little like Chippendale. But it's easier to get a foreign language and to have someone speak it and make it come across as a real language than just to make one up. Because when you make one up, it tends to sound like English, just rearranged.
Pig
phonies, right. It tends to be pig Latin. So what we've done in the past is really just take interesting words and use them. Sometimes mix Swahili with Chinese or something. I mean, there's no attempt to make it literal.
Backwards sometimes.
Backwards is a limited thing because things are generally can be identified as backwards.
Right, right.
These are voices that we've recorded and stuff, and as if they were just, you're in the forest and you suddenly go into the Ewok village and you're just trucking through it. You hear what they're doing.
The Ewok environment was composed of this map painting, a California forest, and this studio set in London.
Hey.
So if you could just get him louder on that. So then the next guy says, more firewood.
Okay.
I look to Mark and say, well, that didn't do us very much good.
And I say, but these are my friends. 3PO, tell them. They must be set free. Then move.
3PO, tell them if they don't do as you wish, you'll become angry and use your magic.
But Master, look, what magic? I couldn't possibly.
Tell them.
It's not going to work as a joke. Unless we both say exactly the same thing.
Okay, what do you want to say?
And it's the exact same
Tell
pace.
Them or just...
Tell them. Let's both do it carefully.
Okay. Tell them.
Oh, can I do it too?
No.
Okay.
Right through the end of the whole
great.
Movie.
Really. So you put the down putting down to later.
Yes. Next, actually. Next. And then the levitation. And then the undoing.
Okay.
All right, the actors step in, please. Come and rehearse them, Bill!
25 feet 7. You sort of realize that these would be good allies.
Uh-huh.
So what you're going to do is make them allies.
That's
so you're just going to sort of play along,
right,
and wait until your moment, and then you're going to...
It's very telling that I let them take my weapons. There's a moment there where I could either strike out or
you could
relax.
Kill them all.
Well, you got a sense of the future. You got a sense of the fact that it's these little funny teddy bears that could destroy the Empire.
Uh-huh.
It's always... In a fairy tale.
Uh-huh.
It's always being nice to the little bunny rabbit on the side of the road that gives you the magic that makes you go and get the princess from the evil witch.
The Ewoks are a variation on a concept that was part of George's vision of Star Wars from the beginning.
In the original screenplay, it was a society of Wookiees who had this giant ground battle with the Empire at the end of the film, and also a space battle, and they were trained to fly ships. And they were able to take over the Empire. Well, in the evolution of the script, I realized I couldn't do this giant battle. When I came to the third film, and the battle was back in again, and I could actually do the battle, I couldn't use Wookiees because I established Chewbacca as being a relatively sophisticated creature. He flies spaceships, runs around. He's not the primitive that he was in the original screenplay. So I had to develop a new kind of Wookiee, or a new kind of creature, that was primitive, a new primitive society. So what I decided to do was, since they were the underdog, so to speak, what I'd do is, instead of making them incredibly tall the way Wookiees are, I'd make them incredibly short. And at the same time, to make them look different from Wookiees, I'd give them short fur instead of long fur. That's really where the Ewok evolved.
There is one that's sort of right over there.
Uh-huh.
You should look at the one that we've done. We've very carefully brought all this down and across here and there. Otherwise, it looks like flesh, and that all begins to merge. It looks like a human face.
Ewoks getting ready to rise. This is the last live-action sequence shot for the saga.
Okay, we're going to keep you 12 here. We're going to spread you out through the bushes, and you come into this position.
The Ewok battle was one of the main inspirations for the whole project when I first started Star Wars, and it evolved out of my interest in a project I'd been working on at the time about the Vietnam War. And one of the more fascinating aspects of that project was the human spirit, the human element, being able to withstand an onslaught of high technology, and how the high technology had failed.
To win their war against the Empire, the Ewoks had to recruit allies among the special effects people. Appropriately, most of their work was with miniatures.
In the first film, we took special effects from a kind of zero point and got it up and running to the point where I could tell the story that I wanted to tell, space battle, fast moving. And get the point across, just barely. A lot of it was done editorially, a lot of it was done sort of tricks, sleight of hand. But we had gone so far in realizing a concept of special effects, of just moving spaceships. I mean, being able to pan with spaceships and be able to have a certain cinematic freedom in shooting those kinds of effects, that had a very powerful impact on the storytelling, a dramatic impact. It's just learning to use the medium more effectively. In the first film, we had maybe 20 colors to paint with, and this time we've had 40 colors to paint with. Well, it doesn't mean it's going to be a better painting by any stretch of the imagination, but it does give the artist more area to roam around in and to advance that art and the technology to the point where we can express ourselves in special effects much more articulately.
I'm going in.
Here goes nothing. Now lock onto the strongest power source. It should be the power generator.
Special effects are just a tool, a means of telling a story. People have a tendency to confuse them as an end to themselves. A special effect without a story is a pretty boring thing.
Effects in the story service. The duel in The Empire Strikes Back.
You are beaten. It is useless to resist. Don't let yourself be destroyed as Obi-Wan did. There is no escape. Don't make me destroy you. Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough! He told me you killed him!
No. I am your father.
No. No. It's not true. That's impossible!
Search your feelings. You know it to be true.
No!
As that evolved, and say I did the first film, I didn't know that how the public would take all this. and that it would be as successful as it was, and Darth Vader would become the character that he became. So when I got down to the second film, I had to make a decision about whether I was really going to go through with this thing of him being his father. Finally decided that that really was the way, I mean, it was the original story, and that was the one I really liked the most, and so I'd stick with it.
In Jedi, father and son faced one another for the last time.
In the end, I had a problem with, in the fight between Luke and his father, of why he makes the final turn. Luke makes the final turn to the bad side of the Force and tries to kill his father.
Use your aggressive feelings, boy. Let the heat flow through you.
Obi-Wan has taught you well.
This was the moment toward which the entire saga had always aimed.
I will not fight you, father.
But ironically, a vital, immediate motivation was still missing when we came to shoot it.
Richard was trying to block out the fight between Luke and Vader, and we got down to that point underneath the throne room there, and he said, you know, the script sort of said, and Vader says something that upsets Luke, or something vague like that. I can't remember exactly what the script said, but it was very vague. Spark, and we didn't have that actual moment that we needed where Luke, you got the sense that Luke is hiding, he's not going to fight him, he refuses to fight, he'd rather die first, and then something turns him around and makes him fight. And I had never really come up with a satisfactory answer to that, of what he could possibly say that would set Luke off, and then it just, let's say, in the process of evolving the script and evolving the importance of Leia as the sister, you know, it was sitting right there in front of my face, and it became obvious that turning her to the dark side would be the thing that would set Luke off again.
If you will not turn to the dark side, then perhaps she will.
Of the Empire duel. The symbols are the same, but now their meanings are reversed.
Never. I'll never turn to the dark side. You failed, Your Highness. I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
The drama is archetypal. Its roots go deep into the mythic past we all share.
If you will not return, you will be destroyed.
Now, at last, son will cry out to father, and in the response to that cry, a saga would reach its climactic heights.
Now, young Skywalker, you will die.
Luke!
Vader has been this become been thrust into this huge persona that I never expected to have happen. Do I still take the mask off and have him be this funny old man? Well, again, I sort of came to the decision of that was the original story, that's the way it should be, and if the public can't deal with it, then what can I do about it? A lot of people have objected to the fact there's a human in there at all. But the film is about human frailties, it's not about monsters.
Luke, help me take this mask off.
But you'll die.
Nothing can stop that now. Just for once, let me look on you with my own eyes.
I think what happens in a project when you're with it and with the characters is, which is what happened to me in the first one, sort of led me along this course, is you fall in love with the characters and you fall in love with the environment. It's like a home. You feel very comfortable making up things that happen in there. It becomes your own little fantasy land, I think. And the reality is I love that world. I mean, there are friends there. It's like a home. I have a home there. And so there's always going to be a desire on my part to go home again or to be with my friends again. Sooner or later you have to leave home and go on to some other place.